Alright everyone, and welcome back to my Nier Automata Very Hard Guided Walkthrough. We're back at the Resistance Camp after defeating Adam in the previous episode, so now it's time to do a little bit of upgrading, and specifically to change my set of weapons. However, there is still a weapon missing, but it can be found in between this area and the next. It's the weapon that Nier started out with in the original game, and this one it can be found in the sewers by fishing. In other words, I'm talking about the iron pipe.
To 9S.
This is 9S. Go ahead.
I have an incoming message for 2B and 9S from the commander. Initiating playback. 2B, 9S. We've lost contact with several Yorha units that were on their way to the surface. Their black boxes are online, so we presume they're still alive. We've tracked the location of their signals, so I need all Yorha units on the surface to head over and investigate. End transmission.
I heard something about that back at the Resistance camp.
Target location confirmed. I'm worried about the other androids. We should probably check this out as soon as possible.
And as I said in the previous episode, my choice of weapons is based on the addition of critical attacks. And the reason I'm going to combine two small swords is... well, take a look. Fast as fuck. Small swords may be less powerful, but it becomes a different story if you can attack this quickly and with seemingly limitless stamina. So now let's first head to the sewers to get the iron pipe and then upgrade that one to level 2 as well. Another benefit of fishing in the sewers is that you can sell all the junk you catch for quite a bit of money.
Report. Fresh.
Okay, so as you see, I was even able to upgrade the iron pipe to level 3 already. And my second set has the Fang of the Twins greatsword. I currently have that as my primary weapon, but I will probably change that to the secondary one later on, for when I'm facing groups of enemies. But as I said, I will mainly use the combination of two small swords, each of which have a chance of doing critical damage, as I explained in the previous episode. And another very important thing to mention is that I purchased the Mirage Pod Program, which I will use throughout the entire game, but specifically during the upcoming boss fight. Very important program to have. Yeah, I think everyone can appreciate this area, especially the first time you get here. It's quite a surreal break in tone after everything you've been through up to this point. Oh, of course, things... there's actually no punishment for killing these machines, and they drop some pretty good materials, but come on, they are so happy together. So we're definitely not going to attack them. Alright, so let's talk about what's up ahead. Because this area contains my favorite boss fight in the game, the fight against Beauvoir, the beauty-obsessed opera singer. Now, I haven't mentioned this before, but I'm playing the Japanese version with the language set to English. When this game came out, it was out in Japan a few weeks before the European and American version. So I purchased this one from the Japanese store to get it early. I'm actually not sure about whether there are any gameplay differences between these versions, but one rather peculiar and essentially detrimental decision was to change Beauvoir and her love interest Sartre's names into their first names. So in the American and US version, they are called Simone and Jean-Paul. Now, obviously, these characters are named after Simone de Beauvoir and Jean-Paul Sartre, but that is hardly as obvious in the Euro and US versions. I mean, it's not like everyone playing this game has a background in philosophy, so just calling these characters Beauvoir and Sartre at least makes it clear as day who they are named after. I suspect that most people playing the Euro and US versions will simply regard Simone and Jean-Paul as random names without any deeper meaning behind them. Which is kind of a shame, because everything about the story in this game screams that it is all metaphor. To draw an analogy, if you think of the book Animal Farm, which is a book that is really about communism, the Russian Revolution, and the historical events of that time, but framed as a story about animals living together on a farm. The point is that everything in the story is a metaphor. So if someone would ask you what is Animal Farm about, and you would then say that it's about animals living together on a farm, and you would then merely summarize the events, then you're not actually talking about the story itself, you're talking about the presentation of the story. And in essence, the same principle applies to this game, if you merely regard it as a story about androids fighting alien machines and the misery they go through. Anyway, it is completely optional, but I'm going to fight the Goliath tank over here. And it serves as a good demonstration of why I like combining two small swords. No, 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 not let's play, walk through.
These machines are heavily armed. We'll regret it later if we let them escape. So let's take them out.
Okay, let's start by charging the two pods I have to fire two lasers instead of one. And then get some rapid attacks in before it has a chance to move. As you can see, if you are close, most projectiles will go over you, but of course you can't exactly stay close. Now the tank will try to run you over, but only start spamming the dodge button after you get the first dodge animation. By that I mean that in essence your first dodge needs to be timed, but you can spam dodge afterwards if you're still in harm's way. But that's not a reliable way to get your first dodge animation. I sincerely hope that that explanation is clear enough. As I said before, the dodging in this game is a little bit complex. And as you could see, when it does the laser attack, make sure you are close, it will go over you.
What's this? Some kind of crystal?
Analysis. It is a core fragment from the machine life form. It is similar in structure to a plant cell.
A plant cell?
Machine cores are always great to have because you can sell them for basically a small fortune. So it's an easy way to get a lot of money. As you probably expect, the reason I'm going back is to save, because if I happen to die in the roller coaster, I would have to fight the tank again.
What's this?
Analysis. It is a device that propels humans on rails at high speeds for the purposes of amusement. It was commonly referred to as a roller coaster.
Humans sure are strange creatures.
Oh yeah, the presentation and music of this game is absolutely brilliant. Okay, here we have multiple enemies at once, so it requires a bit of multitasking. A good thing to remember is that these flying enemies cannot fire directly underneath, so if you can get under them, you can focus on the enemy on the other side. Also, make sure to take the ground enemies out first, they are way more dangerous. After all, you can counter the projectiles of the flying enemies with your pod, but the walking enemies pretty much have to be dodged.
Resistance members detected beneath this room.
Yeah. Oh yes, epic fucking fight. But the first phase has a rather peculiar design feature. Beauvoir's life bar is fake in some sense, because you don't have to attack her at all, and once she has gone through her entire moveset, the second phase will start and she will automatically have half her life bar left. Okay, crucial thing here, equip the Mirage program. Because as awesome as this fight is, we need it to counter some very unfortunate poor design, and you'll see in a minute what I mean. Missiles can be easily outrun, but only when she fires four of them. She can also do a large barrage of missiles and those follow you. Okay, lasers, they are not active yet when they are dark red. Just keep in between them, but remember that your running speed is faster than the laser's movement, so don't run into them. Okay, this is the Mirage program. It's an attack, but it can also function as a dodge because you are invulnerable during that animation. So there are instances where you can use it as an alternative way to dodge. Alright, the rings is just a matter of jumping in between them. And if you want to be cheesy, just run towards the edge of the arena and they cannot hit you at all. And as I said, you don't need to attack her, so I'm just firing at her because why the hell not. Okay, here's where things go to shit. The camera angle is going to completely fuck you over near the end of this session of projectiles. So we're going to save ourselves using the Mirage program. It starts with bullets that you can simply destroy with potfire, but after a while the darker ones will get into the mix, and the camera will move by itself, obstructing your view. So here just position yourself in between the bullets, and the moment that you cannot see what's going on anymore, activate the Mirage program to save yourself. Seriously, what the hell were they thinking having you dodge projectiles that you can't even see coming? It kinda pisses me off, but there are a lot of weird design choices in this game, unfortunately. Oh, and make sure to switch back to the laser program. Anyway, that ends the first phase. Yeah, you gotta love that the music turns 8-bit for these hacking sessions, that's a nice touch.
It's trying to hack us! If we take hacking damage, it'll affect our bodies as well! Tubi!
Beautiful! Beautiful! I must be beautiful!
Those look like corpses.
Are we seriously being attacked with dead androids?
Wait, I don't think... 2B, I'm detecting black box signals. They are dead. They've been turned into weapons.
All right, this ends now.
Okay, this is another part where the camera is a bit of a problem, because you don't have depth perception and you need to jump. Fortunately, these waves aren't lethal, but merely start a hacking game. And contrary to what you would expect, failing at hacking is not an instant death even on very hard. You do only have one hit point during hacking, but you can fail like around 3 or 4 times before it counts as a death. And make sure to make good use of the minimap because of the camera angle.
The enemy's hacking pattern. I'm going to try to hack it back. Keep it busy.
You got it.
Alright, now your attacks do matter because this life bar is real. Okay, the laser becomes active. Oh, well, right now apparently. Well, that is going to happen on this difficulty, so let's just try again. Fortunately, you do have the opportunity to pick up your old body before the attacks start.
I think 2B. I'm detecting black box signals. They are dead. They've been turned into weapons!
All right. This ends now.
Enemy's hacking pattern. I'm going to try to hack it back. Keep it busy.
You got it.
Alright, back where we were. Now it is important to get close so you can do melee damage, but most of our attacks don't allow you to do that. So make sure to make good use of the laser pod program. Because we're going to try to stun her, which will give an opportunity to do massive melee damage.
Saturation attack triggered by enemy consciousness data. Failure to destroy it quickly may lead to serious damage in memory regions.
There, she's on fire. Now jump up because her upper body takes more damage. And that is our actual weak point. So here is where the fast attacks of the dual small swords really shine. And don't worry about the attacks from behind, because those are hacking waves, not lethal projectiles. Okay, most dangerous part, but she's almost dead. Keep your distance, because she can move really quickly now. Oh crap, that almost went wrong. Keep your distance. These waves can easily be jumped over. And as soon as level up appears, the fight ends.
Thanks for the assist.
Oh, you mean the hacking? No worries. Us scanners are pretty good at that kind of thing. I've got your back anytime.
We have to save those androids.
I'm sorry, 2B. Their circuits are fried. I think they were only being kept alive by that enemy.
Oh.
So,
what is it?
That machine had some pretty weird things to say, huh? It's almost like it had actual emotion.
The machines don't have feelings. You said that yourself.
Yeah, I guess.
Alright, that killing explosion at the end might as well get into a feminist rect compilation, I suppose, being that the philosopher Simone de Beauvoir was a French radical feminist. But it seems to be that the characters who are named after philosophers in this game, which are essentially all named machines with the exception of Adam and Eve, are the exact opposite of their real-life counterparts. As you know, you discover in Route B that Beauvoir was obsessed with beauty to acquire love from Sartre, which was not reciprocated in the slightest, whereas the real-life Beauvoir and Sartre were in a lifelong relationship. And moreover, Simone de Beauvoir was completely against female obsession over looks for trying to get the approval of men. And the in-game character being a mirror image, so to say, also goes for Pascal, leader of the village we're heading to, named after Blaise Pascal, which I may or may not pronounce correctly, which is also a French philosopher and a Christian, probably most well known for the concept of Pascal's wager. Which, interestingly enough, as far as I'm aware, there is not a direct reference to in this game. but it seems to be more about his position towards the state of humanity and light of original sin. Again, quite contrary to the attitude of his in-game counterpart. Although, having said that, he is positive but not naive in regard to in regard to the nature of machines and how they can be dangerous and unreliable. However, the in-game Pascal is an optimist seeking salvation by freeing himself from the system, whereas the real Pascal was a pessimist seeking salvation from within the dominant system of Christianity.
Supplies up from Earth to the moon in the bunker. There are no spare parts or fuel in space after all.
Huh. So why don't the machines, or the aliens who created them, attack the bunker directly? They originally came here from outer space, right?
Well, there are a few theories about that, but no one knows for sure. Hard to tell what an alien is thinking, you know?
They all have white flags.
Looks like they really don't want to fight.
Hello. Before we begin, there's something you must understand. We are not your enemies.
2B, we can't trust anything the machines say.
I understand that you see us as the enemy, but... Well, anyway, my name is Pascal. I'm the leader of this village. Those who reside here desire nothing more than to live a peaceful existence. You'll see that it's true.
You know, let's have a quick chat with Sartre, and then you can also see when the machine next to him calls him by his name that this is indeed the Japanese version, because he doesn't refer to him as Jean-Paul. Remember, by the way, that 2B stated that emotions are prohibited, as if it was a Yora rule. Which is a kind of foreshadowing when you see that other androids never mention that, and even act contrary to it.
Operator 6-0 to 2B. Time for your regularly scheduled contact.
2B here. What's wrong? Definitely not the person to discuss this with.
I don't think I can stand spending one more day in this bunker.
You leaving would be bad for me. It would affect mission efficiency.
Are you saying you need me, 2B?
All Model B combat units require the assistance of an operator. So...
2B!
That's all. Closing this channel.
Of course, as we learn at the end of the game, to B's cold, distant, and seemingly emotionless behavior was her way of coping with her task as an execution unit. Well, anyway, let's end the episode here. Please leave a like, let me know your thoughts in the comment section, and I hope to see you back in the next episode.